So life process, the first chapter that will give weightage of 8 to 10 marks. And it is one of the important chapter because it contains so many life processes like reproduction, reproduction we have done, respiration, nutrition, circulation, and excretion. Visible screen is visible. Continuously, people are coming. Good. So, what is life process? First of all, sum total of all the biochemical reactions, sum total of all the biochemical reaction, it means those reaction which is taking place in our body that involves enzymes and they will help in several metabolic process. So the sum total of all the biochemical reaction that is taking place in a human body is known as life processes. Biochemical means metabolic reactions. Any doubt to anybody in the definition? Let me see, new people are there to join. Okay. Use the chat box. Good afternoon, everyone. Use the chat box, no doubt. Okay. Finally, people are responding in the chat. Good. So one of the important characteristics of being alive is life process. It means life process will take place in those organisms only who are living. It means that they are not dead. So one of the basic processes is movement. Something that is living, alive, will show certain movement, and just these movement, sometimes these movement will be helping in respiration, so respiratory movement, excretion, circulation, they will help in eating food also, that will become nutrition. So nutrition, respiration, circulation, excretion, reproduction, control, coordination, growth and movement, these all are the important life processes. Is it okay? Any doubt in the definition of life process? No doubt. Okay, so what is nutrition? First metabolic process that we are going to start, nutrition. So what is nutrition? Still two people. Okay, nutrition is the process of taking nutrient. Nutrition, simple, intake of nutrient. Intake of nutrient is known as nutrition, simple. And what is now nutrient? Nutrient is organic or inorganic. It can be organic also, it can be inorganic also. That is required to maintain the life and survival of a living organism. So for the maintenance of life as well as survival of a living organisms, those organic and inorganic compounds, those organic or inorganic substances that we take, intake in our body is known as nutrient. So one of the simplest nutrient is glucose. Glucose is a simple food. It is the simplest nutrients. Other carbohydrate, fats, vitamins, proteins, minerals, roughage, water. These all are the nutrient list. Okay, the process of obtaining food by an organism is known as nutrition. Nutrition means intake of nutrient by organism If we will get the nutrition, then only we will get energy, and then we will do our basic metabolic process, that is life process. Is it clear what is nutrient and what is nutrition? Say yes or no. Clear? Akshita, Yeshika, very good. At least these girls are replying. Nice. Next. Nutrition can be of so many types. Autotropic, heterotropic. Now here so many means. Basically it is two only here. But autotropic is also divided. Like we can call it self-deriving nutrients or self-deriving nutrition. So the process by which we will get nutrient in which we don't have to depend upon anyone else. We don't have to ask anybody else for food is known as autotropic. Auto means self-dependent. Hetero means we have to depend upon another's. Depend upon others. So in order to understand best example of autotropic nutrition is green plants, because they don't have to depend upon another for the food. Simply what will be there? There will be chlorophyll in them, and then they can do photosynthesis that you are studying from grade 6. Photosynthesis is the process in which the plant can prepare their own food. Heterotropic, it means no photosynthesis. We have to dependent upon others. We have to you can say that we have to look here and there for the food. So it can be of so many types. Holozoic, saprophytic, parasitic, mixotropic. One by one, we will study each of them. Any doubt in the type of nutrition? Symbiotic. See, symbiotic is not a nutrition. Symbiotic is a relationship, Shreyash. Symbiotic, it means a mutual relationship in which one will benefit another. Another will benefit the first one. It means give and take relationship. Like lichen. In lichen, there is a combination of algae and fungi. Fungi does not have chlorophyll, so it can't do photosynthesis. So it will give raw material to algae. Algae, being green in nature, they have chlorophyll. They will prepare the food and then they will give it to the fungi. It means give and take symbiotic. That is a relationship. Okay. So autotrophic, the first very slide, as you can see on the board, green, green color, leaves are there. Auto self-tropic nutrition literally means self-nutrition. I don't think that people have doubt in this. It is one of the easiest thing that you can see in biology. Okay. Self-nutrition. So autotrophic mode of nutrition is that mode of nutrition in which an organism makes its own food from the simple inorganic material like carbon dioxide, water. These all things are needed to be present in the surroundings. So in autotrophic mode of nutrition, there is no need of anybody else. Simply the organism is self-sufficient to produce food by the help of the simple inorganic material like CO2, water, sunlight. Okay, so the green plants are the best example. They have autotrophic mode of nutrition. The autotrophic cyanobacteria is one of the another example that will obtain the food by the mode of autotrophic nutrition. So what we have to learn here, that green plants and cyanobacteria, these two are best example of autotrophic nutrition. Are you guys writing? See, all the things are given in the point wise manner, so you can copy it easily. There is nothing like big paragraphs so that you get confused. The slide that has been prepared is prepared in such a way so that you can easily learn the things and write in the same way in the examination. Is it okay? Please everybody write down. Very important. Photosynthesis. What is this? Photosynthesis. Photosynthesis. 6 carbon dioxide, 6 water molecule. Solar energy that is coming from the sun. Glucose molecule is formed. Along with this, 6 oxygen molecule is released. This is a anabolic process. Anabolic means energy absorbing. So energy is absorbed in the form of solar energy. Is it okay? In order to understand, CO2 is coming, light is coming inside the plant, food is getting prepared, already the leaves are green in color, it means they have chlorophyll, water is coming from the roots. Any doubt in this simple process? No doubt. Okay. So this is the reaction that will come in examination. You have to write down like this only. Now, heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Heterotrophic means dependent upon another's. Hetero other tropic nutrition literally means nutrition obtained from others. So see, this is amoeba. Heterotrophic mode of nutrition is that mode of nutrition in which an organism cannot make its own food. I have already told you those organisms which cannot make their own food from the simple inorganic material like CO2, water. So what they have to do? If they can't make their own food, obviously they have to depend upon others for the food. So most of the bacteria, fungi, animals, humans like us, we all have heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Any doubt in this? So easy. So easy. No doubt? Okay. Next, types of heterotrophic. Holozoic, saprophytism, this is also known as saprophytic mode of nutrition, or we all call it saprotrophic mode of nutrition. In some book you can see this also. So one, we can say it's saprophytic also, and we can say it's saprotrophic also at the same time. So holozoic nutrition, the organism feed by ingesting solid organic matter. Solid organic, it means food like this, as we are eating, like rice, chapati, dosa, burger, noodles, pizza. So the organism feed by ingesting solid organic matter, which is then digested. How it is digested? It is broken down into small pieces by the help of our teeth. Then there are so many enzymes present in our body. Saliva is there. Acid is getting released. This we will understand further when we will complete this process in detail, the nutrition. Then after broken down, it will absorb into the blood, and after blood it will go into the cell. So this is holozoic. Holozoic, in which solid molecule is broken down into small pieces and then it is absorbed by the body. We do holozoic nutrition, animals do, insectivorous plants do. Any doubt? Saprophytism. Sapro, dead, rotten. So the organisms will dependent upon not fresh food. It will be dependent upon dead and decaying matter. Is it okay? Still people are waiting. Am I audible, kids? Let me know. Thank you for your reply, Yeshika. So dead and decaying organism, if we will be dependent upon them, then it is known as saprotrophic. And the organisms which will do saprophytic mode of nutrition is known as saprophytes. Okay. So they include bacteria, fungi, which digest the food externally before the nutrients are absorbed. So what they will do? They will digest the food externally, means from outer part, like see this earthworm. Wait. Can you see this? Saprophytic, dead and decaying organisms. very easy. This all you have done in your smaller grade. Parasitism. Obtain nutrients from living organism like lice, bed bugs, ticks. How many people have lice in their head? How many people have lice in their head? Lice, ticks, bed bugs. Leech. Everybody know what is leech? Rajni, please speak. How many people have lice in their head? Nobody? You maintain cleanliness? You wash your head with shampoo? Ma'am, we are very clean, Navya. Very good. At least Navya is speaking. Class, you have to speak in the class. I know that nobody is dirty, but why I am asking this? So that you get interacted. Lice, ticks, bed bugs, leech. So parasite, it means those nutrition will depend upon human body. Okay? And then what will happen? Suppose... why this is not working? Just a second. Suppose this is a human body. Let me take this example. Suppose this is a human body. And on human body, lice, what they will do? They will suck the blood, Aniket. And then there is lice present on the body. Suppose these are lice. On the hair especially. It can be lice, it can be ticks. Ticks are basically found in dogs and cats, not in human. Dog, cat. Okay, so ticks are found in dog and cat, and then leeches can be also there. So what they will do, they will suck the blood. They will not give any benefit to them, to these animals on which they are dependent. They will not give any benefit. Simply what they will do, they will suck their blood. They will get their nutrition and then they will give negative effect to those on which they are dependent. On which they are dependent. Is it okay? Ma'am, why don't tick affect humans? Because they are so thick that as soon as they will come on the human body, they will not get any favorable conditions to live. Because human body does not have hair all over the body, na? Long, long hair. Yes, we have small, small hairs. But you see dogs and cats, their whole body is covered with you can say fur. Is it okay? Yes, ticks are just lice, but they are very bigger as compared to lice. Lice spelling is L-I-C-E, Yeshika, not L-I-E-S. So these parasites can be two types, ectoparasite and endoparasite. Endoparasite means they will present in our body, then they will give harm like tapeworm. Ecto means they will present out of the body, surface of the body, like lice and bed bugs. Okay, no problem. Should I change the slide? Now, photosynthesis again, the important thing. Condition necessary for photosynthesis is sunlight, chlorophyll, carbon dioxide, water. Now, this is something directly from NCERT. And what is that? That is directly from NCERT, and it is very, 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 very important. And that is three basic steps of photosynthesis. Very, very, very important. First step is absorption of sunlight energy by chlorophyll. Suppose this is a green color, beautiful plant. My board is visible. Okay, so this is a green color plant having flower. Now this green plant, they already have chlorophyll, CH I am writing. green green chlorophyll. Now this sunlight that is present as an external source, let me use this orange color so that it's properly visible. Now this sunlight will be absorbed by the green leaves. This sunlight will be absorbed by the green leaves. So who will absorb? Chlorophyll. So first step, absorption of sunlight energy, that is solar energy. Why I am explaining you this? Because this is very important, by chlorophyll. Once the chlorophyll have absorbed the energy, now what will happen? Once the chlorophyll has absorbed the energy, the light energy that was in the form of sunlight, that was actually inside the leaf, will be converted into chemical energy. So conversion of light energy into chemical energy. And then this chemical energy will help in splitting of water molecules. How the water is coming inside the plant body? By the help of roots. These are roots. Now these roots will absorb water. What they will do? They will absorb water because we are giving water to our plants. Now these water will also go inside the leaf by the help of xylem or phloem. Who will go tell me? Water will be conducted by the help of xylem or phloem. Xylem, very good. So that water molecule will be broken down into oxygen and hydrogen. It means the light energy that was absorbed by the chlorophyll, that light energy will be converted into chemical energy. Now this chemical energy will help in splitting of this water molecule into hydrogen and oxygen. Any doubt? Any doubt? No doubt. Good. Now next, reduction of CO2, the most important step, reduction of CO2. This carbon dioxide will be reduced. The carbon dioxide which we are getting from outside, means the plant is getting, not we, because we have to do heterotrophic nutrition. So CO2 will be reduced by the help of hydrogen. See, the hydrogen that is splitted by water molecule, this will help in reduction of CO2 to form carbohydrate. And which carbohydrate we get in photosynthesis, means plant getting photosynthesis? Name the carbohydrate that is produced by plant. Simplest, glucose. Okay, yeah, that is sucrose. So carbohydrate will be formed, and that is glucose, by utilizing the chemical energy. And in this way, this glucose, a very, 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 very important nutrient, is formed. Is it okay? Is it okay? Should we move further? Have you noted down all these three important points? Yes, okay. See, the same thing is given by the help of the diagram. Now, what is holozoic nutrition? Holozoic nutrition is divided into steps. And these steps are ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation, and egestion. Let me explain you these points. Ingestion means intake of food. Digestion means breakdown of that food into simple molecule. Absorption means digested of that food into bloodstream. Assimilation means transport and use of absorbed food by the body cells. Egestion means removal of the undigested food. Any problem? Any problem, kids, in all these steps? No problem? Chalo. Now let us start nutrition process. First of all, we will give the food. We will intake the food in our mouth. We will churn the food. We will cut the food into pieces, that is mechanical digestion. Who will help in this? Our teeth and tongue. After this, salivary gland is present. Three pairs of salivary glands are there. Largest is parotid gland, submandibulary, and sublingual. Okay, so three pairs are there. Parotid is the largest. They produce more than 1 liter of saliva. So how much they will produce? They will produce more than 1 liter of saliva every day. If there is no saliva, our mouth will become dry. Okay, so just in order to prevent this problem, our saliva will be released from salivary gland, and the saliva will help in the breakdown of starch into maltose. Starch into maltose. Who will break? Salivary amylase. What is another name of salivary amylase? Ptyalin. Another name of salivary amylase is ptyalin. After this, it also contains substances that neutralizes acidic food and slippery substances that make food easier to swallow. So obviously, if there will be no saliva, how we will swallow the food? Any idea how we will swallow the food if we don't have saliva? So what we have to do? We have salivary gland that will help in the breakdown of the complex food into simpler one. It will help in the, we can say, it will break down the starch into maltose, and it will allow the swelling, swallowing of the food. Any doubt? Any doubt? Am I audible, class? Okay. Now, next part is esophagus. What is important about esophagus? The food that is present in esophagus is known as not food. Now they will known as bolus. And this food will move here to here, then here to here, and then here to here. So this is contraction and relaxation. So continuously what it will take place? Contraction and relaxation will continuously take place. Contraction and relaxation of the esophagus in order to movement so that the food can go down, and this contraction and relaxation so that easily bolus can pass in the esophagus is known as peristalsis movement or peristaltic movement. Esophagus, important thing that is mentioned in caps lock, does not contain any enzyme. Esophagus is the one of the part of the alimentary canal that does not contain enzyme. Is it okay? Is it okay? Should we move further? Now next is stomach. Stomach, as you can see J-shaped structure is there. J-shaped muscular organ. Inner folds are there, that is known as ragi. Increase the surface area of the stomach. Surface area will increase, then more and more digestion will take place. Ma'am, does the absence of enzyme in esophagus means there are no glands in esophagus? Yes, Aryan, there is no any digestive gland in esophagus. Good. Doubt clear? So function. First of all, stomach will help in mechanical digestion. Mechanical digestion, it means breaking the food into more simple. Already the food that is coming from esophagus, that is bolus, that will be once again broken down. So how? By churning the bolus. How they will do? They will churning the bolus. Churning means continuously crushing the bolus. And when the crushing will take place, at the same time, stomach will release gastric juices. These gastric juices will also be mixed with the bolus. Okay, in the stomach. From where these gastric juices are released? From the lining of the stomach. See, these internal lining of the stomach will release gastric juices. Is it okay? So what are the gastric juices? Composition, HCl, salt, enzyme, water, mucus. So what is their function? First of all, HCl, that is hydrochloric acid. They will help in breakdown of food and kills bacteria that came along with the food. So hydrochloric acid will help in breaking down of food. And then they will kill the bacteria. For example, suppose we have consumed something that contains little quantity of bacteria. So it will be killed by the gastric juices, hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid is dilute. It's not concentrated. The bolus is now called chyme. Bolus was the food in esophagus. And chyme is the same food in stomach. Any doubt? Any doubt? Hello? I'm audible. Is it easily understood or simply you are saying yes ma'am, so that the class can go? It's easy. Okay. Next is functions of the stomach. What are the stomach function? First is they will allow the digestive enzymes like pepsins to act. Pepsins will help in the digestion of protein. Write down. Pepsin will help in protein digestion. So chemical digestion, that is pepsin breaks protein into polypeptides. So what does the pepsin will do? Pepsin will break down the protein into polypeptides. That is mechanical breakdown. Non-specific defense against microbes. Preparation of iron for absorption. Important thing is that vitamin B12 is there. And the medium will become acidic. Is it okay? Now next. Small intestine, this one is actually it looks small, but when we uncoil it, it will become one of the largest organ of the human body. So small intestine will release intestinal juice. So small intestine will receive the secretion of liver and pancreas. The liver is releasing bile juice, this, and pancreas is releasing pancreatic juice. So one, two. So these both juice will be coming in small intestine. So small intestine like receives secretion of liver and pancreas. Bile juice will also go from liver, pancreatic juice will go from pancreas, and small intestine will release its own juice. And what is the name? Who is going to tell me in the class? What is the name of the juice that is released by small intestine? Intestinal juice is having some name. Succus entricus. Very good, Momita. So now there is a combination of three juices: succus entricus, pancreatic, bile. Now these three will help in the digestion of food. So how they will do? Bile will dilute the stomach contents from stomach. It means that those things which is coming from stomach, they were acidic now because the stomach was little acidic because of release of dilute HCl. So this acidic thing will become dilute in the small intestine. Who will do that? Bile will do that. Optimum pH it will provide so that pancreatic enzyme can work properly. Bile salts are there. It will emulsify fat. It means big molecule of fat will be converted into small molecule by the squeezing process that is known as bile salt. Similarly, if we talk about pancreatic juice, pancreas produces alkaline pancreatic juice. Alkaline means basic. So what are the juices? Amylase, protease, lipase. Amylase will help to digest the starch part. Protease will help to digest protein part. Lipase will help to digest lipid part. So see, fat are fatty acid glycerol by the help of lipase. Starch is getting converted into maltase by the help of amylase. Protein is getting converted into peptones by the help of trypsin. Any doubt? Any doubt to anybody? No doubt. Okay. Still RN is waiting. Okay. Now let me change this. Intestinal juice, also known as succus entricus, the same thing which we have discussed in the last slide is given here. Large intestine, as you can see, this one. Large intestine, acha. Before starting large intestine, small intestine part I haven't discussed. The part of this small intestine, for example, this is the large only. Like this. This is something vestigial organ. This was the small intestine. So this small intestine is divided into duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. Duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. This is a small intestine. After this, this is known as appendix, one of the vestigial organ. This blue color is large intestine. So this is known as cecum. It is divided into few parts. Cecum, this whole is known as colon, and this is known as rectum, and this is the last part, that is anus, last part of alimentary canal. Any doubt, children? Is there any noise? No doubt, no noise. Is there any noise? No noise. Okay. So this large part is cecum, colon, rectum. Main function is that it will help in absorption of water and mineral, digest what remain in food. And cecum is that part, if there is undigested food, if it is still present in the cecum part, this cecum, that will leads to a problem that is known as constipation. And when this appendix will become very large, so that it can cause pain in the body, in the abdominal region, the problem is appendicitis. Is it okay? No, it's present in small intestine, RN. That will increase the surface area for absorption. Okay. So absorption, what will happen? The small molecules that have been broken down into small part, that is after digestion, they will move into the blood stream so that it is carried out by the cells of the body. Now what will be assimilation? The same food molecules suppose this is a small food molecule, this is carried by the blood, is known as absorption. And when the blood will go to each and every cell of our body, it will give the digested food, that is known as assimilation. And the undigested food will come out, that is ejection, expulsion of undigestible material from the body. Any doubt? Any doubt? Crystal clear? Okay. Next is respiration. Respiration is the breakdown of food, that is glucose, to release energy. Now, who will tell me, chalo, before starting respiration, what was the end product of nutrition? Means what we were getting when we were doing nutrition, what do we get? What do we get in nutrition? Why do, huh? Very good, very nice. Aniket Mungara, glucose. Aditi, energy. Very, Aryan, no ATP, CO2. You are going in photosynthesis process. Yeah, energy in the form of glucose. Shobita, very smart girl of today's lecture. We get glucose. So the glucose which we got, this is giving energy. Why do we get glucose? So that we can get energy. But how we will get energy from glucose? Who will tell me? We get nutrition, glucose from nutrition process. But how we will get energy from this glucose? Which metabolic process should be done now so that this glucose can be converted into energy giving something? Very good. So smart kids are there. Akshita, Aditi, Siddharth, everybody smart children. Respiration. So respiration is a catabolic process. Photosynthesis was anabolic process. They both are metabolic process. What is catabolic? Release energy. It means those processes which will release energy, they will become catabolic. Those which will absorb energy, they will become anabolic. So where does this respiration takes place? Respiration takes place in mitochondria. That is why mitochondria is known as powerhouse of the cell, because it can store more and more ATP. So enzymes are a special protein that control the process of respiration. Now we have to discuss how many types of respiration are there. So respiration can be aerobic, anaerobic. Aerobic means presence of oxygen. Anaerobic means lack of oxygen. So when aerobic respiration is there, so glucose is there, oxygen will combine with glucose, it will release carbon dioxide, water molecules, and 38 ATP. How much? 38 ATP. But suppose there is no oxygen. Suppose there is no oxygen, then what will happen? This breakdown of glucose will take place, but this will be incomplete. And just this incomplete breakdown, it will release in the formation of ethyl alcohol. Ethyl alcohol, that is ethanol, CO2. So little energy, 2 ATP, only 2 ATP. So remember children, this ethyl alcohol or ethanol is produced in case of plants. But what about the case of animals? What about the case of animals or human? What will be the product of anaerobic respiration? Very good, Siddharth, lactic acid. But what is the thing that you have to remember? That in anaerobic respiration, only 2 ATP is produced in case of this ethyl alcohol. But when we produce lactic acid, then there is no release of ATP. Remember, there is no release of CO2, sorry. So what you have to keep it in your mind, in anaerobic respiration, CO2 is produced in plant. But in case of human or any animal, the product will become lactic acid and there will be no CO2, but the ATP will be same, 2 ATP, little quantity. So which respiration is better, aerobic or anaerobic? Which respiration is better? Aerobic. Very good. So you can see here, glucose, first it will not get any oxygen, it means anaerobic condition. It will get converted into pyruvate in the cytoplasm. As soon as it get oxygen, see, as soon as presence of oxygen, it will run in the mitochondria to release CO2 water energy. If it will not get oxygen, then it will be converted into ethanol CO2 energy, the same thing in the plant. And when it is not getting oxygen in presence of human, then it will convert it into lactic acid energy. See, no CO2. No CO2 is formed in muscle cells in anaerobic condition. Is it okay? Done? Okay, so let us move further. Now here I would like to add one more thing. Glucose conversion into pyruvate in cytoplasm in anaerobic condition is known as glycolysis. Is it okay? Next is organs of the respiratory systems. What are the organs? So those organs are nose, pharynx, larynx, as you can see in this diagram, trachea, bronchi, lungs, alveoli. Who is the unit of respiration? Unit of respiration. I'm waiting for your reply. Name the unit of respiration. Alveoli. Very, 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 very good. So see what will happen, oxygen will come and then it will move into the trachea. Trachea is made up of C-shaped cartilaginous ring, so that when there is extra pressure of the air, the trachea does not collapse. After this, bronchi, bronchioles, and in the last there is alveoli. Is it okay? Next is another metabolic process, circulatory system, that contain one of the pumping organ, heart, which actually look in movies you have seen like this, but actually it's not like this, it's like this. Any doubt? This is heart, then blood vessels. Blood vessels can be of so many type, like so many means basically three, one, two, artery, vein, capillaries. And then the fluid that is itself circulating in the body is known as blood, circulating fluid. Should we move to the next? Sure. Okay. What is blood? First of all, blood is slightly alkaline in nature. It means slightly basic in nature with a pH of 7.35 to 7.45. Blood is a fluid connective tissue. Why? Because it is flowing here and there inside the blood vessels. It color varies from bright to dark red. Dark red is deoxygenated blood. Bright red is oxygenated blood. Oxygenated blood contain more and more oxygen. Deoxygenated contain more and more CO2. It's not semi-solid, it is fluid. Yeshika, it is a fluid. Liquid. Okay. Now see, these are the blood vessels. Why does the lack of O2 changes the color of blood? Because CO2 will make the, you can say this carbon dioxide will have a greater affinity as compared to oxygen. So that's why the RBC will greatly bind with the CO2. That will lead to the change in the color. Composition of CO2 will make the blood dark red. So see, what is the differences between the arteries and veins? Artery, vein. Can you see this? Is it visible? So arteries are thick walled. They are thick walled. Veins are thin walled. Why they are thick walled? See, because artery will carry oxygenated blood. First you have to learn artery carry oxygenated blood except pulmonary artery. Veins carry deoxygenated blood except pulmonary vein. Is it okay? Okay. So oxygenated blood is coming from heart and then it is going to each part of the body. So it is, you can say, suppose this is your body.
Ma'am, I have doubt.
Mm-hmm. Please.
We often use the words corpuscle and cell interchangeably. Are they the same thing or do they have different meanings?
No, they both are same. Some books follow red blood cells, old books, and now new books are following red blood corpuscles.
Oh, so they're the same thing.
They are same thing. There's nothing like that. For example, let me tell you something. Mm-hmm. For example, this plasma membrane is selectively permeable, is written in new book. But in old books, old edition, you will see that it is written the word semi-permeable. That plasma membrane is semi-permeable. New books are writing plasma membrane is selectively permeable. So meaning is same, only they are using more better words because these words describe those things in a more better way.
Okay, so for WBCs, we can call them white blood corpuscles as well.
No problem.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
So see, arteries carry oxygenated blood, veins will carry deoxygenated blood. So oxygenated, deoxygenated, everybody know this exceptional case to everybody, you have to learn it. Arteries have no walls, veins have walls. Now what is the reason? Artery carry oxygenated blood. Suppose this is your body. Let me remove this. Actually, this is your body. And in this body, there is a heart. Okay. Now this heart is giving oxygenated blood. Suppose. So oxygenated blood have to go in each part of the body. So much suppose. Up and here and there. So they will, you can say they are moving under gravity or against gravity in this part. The heart is situated in the slightly left position. So obviously most of the part of the body is below heart. So the blood is moving in the arteries under gravitational force or against gravitational force. I want answer. Very easy question I have asked. Is there somebody who is answering? Am I audible, kids? Under, not both, under. So when it is working under gravity, so does it needed to be means it need to be very much having walls or something, or it does not need walls? Walls, it means something that will prevent backward flow of the blood. Yeah, there is also, Shreyash, no problem, but I am asking maximum, majority. So the thing is, first of all, listen carefully. Whenever the blood has to move in the effect of gravity, so obviously the blood will move towards gravity. There is no chance that it will move opposite. So there is no need of walls. this blood will flow in under huge pressure. In our tree, the oxygenated blood will flow in huge, or we can say in high pressure. So that is known as thick wall. Means the artery should be thick wall, so that if the blood is in the pressure, it should not get rupture. Are these two points clear? Chalo, now everybody know oxygenated blood, this so you have to learn. Now let's talk about veins. Carry deoxygenated blood except pulmonary veins. So deoxygenated blood is coming from heart, or it is coming from all the cells of the body. Now let me know your answer. Deoxygenated blood is coming from heart or coming from all the cells of the body? All the cells of the body. So they are moving under gravity or against gravity? They have to come towards heart against gravity. So they need walls. Let me draw this. Suppose this is heart. Okay. Now this is your body. There are so many cells. There are so many cells. Multicellular we all are. Now the blood is deoxygenated. I am using blue color because it contains more and more CO2. So the blood is deoxygenated. So it is moving towards gravity or against gravity? Obviously against gravity. And when it is moving against gravity, the blood vessel, that is veins, in which this deoxygenated blood is going, there should be walls. See, this is wall. What is wall? Once the blood is moving like this, till here it has reached, this wall will get closed. This wall will get closed. Similarly, the blood will move against gravity, upside. As the blood reaches this point, this walls will get closed. Why they are getting close continuously? Yes, to prevent backflow. So there is need of walls. Veins contain walls. V for veins, V for wall. So easy to learn. A for artery, no wall. V for veins, so there is wall. Is it okay? Okay, and now one more point that is discussed here, that they are thin walled. Why? Because in veins the blood is not under very high pressure. It is moving smoothly. But in artery the blood is in very high pressure, so it should be thick walled, so that it should not get rupture. The arteries should not get rupture. Is it okay? Is it okay? Okay, fine. So let us move to another part. That is one of the most important part of today's lecture, of today's class also, today's chapter. You can understand the structure of the heart. This is vena cava, largest vein. Please write, this is aorta, largest artery. Largest artery. Someone is asking something. Sorry. This table can be asked for 3 marks. Yes, Surya, that is very, very important table. Everything I have prepared the slide in the same way so that you can write the same thing in the board and you can get marks. No deduction. So this is heart. Aorta is the largest artery. 4 chambers are there. Right atrium, right ventricle. Left atrium, left ventricle. 2 walls are there. This is tricuspid wall and this is bicuspid wall. This is pulmonary artery. This is pulmonary veins. Why the word pulmonary is given? Because they are going towards lung. Okay. Now we have to discuss in this double circulation. What is double circulation? Should we start? Okay. Ready? Right atrium. Right ventricle. Then there is lungs. Left atrium. Wait. Left atrium. Left ventricle, there is aorta. Now let us start. The blood is coming in the right atrium of the heart from the body by the help of the largest vein of the body, that is vena cava. Vena cava, largest vein. Okay, so this largest vein is there, vena cava, that is bringing which type of blood? Which type of blood? Oxygenated or deoxygenated? Deoxygenated. Very good, Surya. Deoxygenated blood. And this deoxygenated blood will go in the right ventricle by the help of tricuspid valve. Okay, from right ventricle, it will go to the lungs by the help of a special artery, that is the exceptional case, pulmonary artery. So pulmonary artery will receive the deoxygenated blood from the right ventricle and then it will give to the lungs. Now what the lungs will do? Lungs will convert this deoxygenated blood into oxygenated by giving oxygen. This is oxygenated blood. Now what will happen? This oxygenated blood will move in the left atrium by the help of a special vein, that is pulmonary vein. Any doubt? Now by this pulmonary vein, once it has entered left atrium, then it will enter left ventricle by the help of a special valve. And what is the name of that valve? Bicuspid valve. Once the left ventricle will receive the blood, it will give the same blood, that is oxygenated to the largest artery of the body, that is aorta, largest artery. So this largest artery will carry this oxygenated blood to the body. Is it okay? So this cycle will go on. Now the body will, after receiving oxygenated blood, the body cell will do respiration, and as a result of respiration, they will produce deoxygenated blood. And now this deoxygenated blood will once again go to largest vein, that is vena cava, and once again this process will repeat. So in order to complete one circulation, how many times the blood is going inside the heart? In order to complete one circulation, how many times the blood is going inside the heart? Twice. How you can analyze twice? See, once the blood was deoxygenated, it went to right atrium, right ventricle, lungs. After right atrium, right ventricle, it has left the heart and it jumped towards lungs. So one flow, once it has become oxygenated from the lungs, now it will move towards left atrium, left ventricle. It is also heart. So second time it is coming in heart. So once it will carry the deoxygenated blood from the heart, it will go to the lungs. Again, after getting oxygenated blood, it will come back into the heart. So in this way, in order to complete one circle, one circulation, the blood is moving how many times? Two times. And that is the reason that this is known as double circulation. Double circulation. The blood flow twice in the heart in order to complete one circulation. Is it okay? Okay. Now my next question, what is the outermost protective layer of the heart? Outermost protective layer of the heart. Pericardium. So this is known as pericardium. Okay. And after this, one more question that is coming in my mind. Huh? The four chambers of the heart is divided into four parts by the help of which layer? The heart is divided into four chambers by the help of which layer? Septa. Very good. Very, very good. Now let us move to another metabolic process. See, double circulation already. I have mentioned one slide so that whenever you will revise, it will be easy. Transportation, that is circulation in plant. We don't use the word circulation in case of plant. We use the word circulation in case of human beings. Transportation in plants. So vascular tissue is there, xylem and phloem are there. The whole story we will complete. Transportation in plants. Soil is the natural and richest source of raw material. Everybody know. Raw material, what are the raw material? Nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. NPK, macronutrients. So the soil will give NPK to the roots of the plant. Plant absorb water and minerals. Once the plant has absorbed these water and minerals using xylem and phloem, not phloem here, only xylem is responsible for transportation of water and mineral from soils to the other parts of the plant. So what the xylem will do? Transport water and mineral from soil by roots to transport to the leaves. As the distance between root and leaf is very large, everybody know, this is a plant, these are the roots. As the distance from the roots to the leaves, what will happen is very large. So there is diffusion not sufficient. It's not diffusion only that will do this activity. There will be ascent of sap, absorption mechanism, passive absorption. These all things you will study in larger classes. So plant use slow transport system but large as required in tall plants to transport energy from leaves and raw material from the roots. So there are special cells that are forming vascular tissue, that is xylem and phloem. It means there is no diffusion that can take place for such a more and more distance, for such a huge height. So there is a conducting tissue, that is, we can say it is a vascular tissue, that is xylem and phloem. A group of special cells forming vascular tissue transport water and nutrients to all the cells of the plant. Two types of the tissues are xylem and phloem. So they are conducting tissue, they are vascular tissue. Xylem transport water and minerals. Somebody is trying to admit. Okay. Xylem will help in transportation of water and minerals from the soil. And phloem will help in the movement of glucose that is formed by the leaves as a result of photosynthesis. Any doubt in this slide? Any doubt? No doubt. People are late. Vessels, tracheids of the root, stems, leaves, they all are connected to form a continuous system so that xylem can transport water to all parts of the plant. Water is moved in xylem. Water is done by xylem. It is unidirectional. Learn it. After this, phloem. There is phloem. It's not written, but still I will write phloem. Is bidirectional. So xylem is unidirectional and phloem is bidirectional. Plants use different mechanism to pull water through xylem. Evaporation is also done, that is known as transpiration. The loss of water in the form of water vapor is called transpiration. Why this transpiration is necessary? Because it will regulate temperature, it will help in absorption of water and upward movement of water and minerals. This transpiration will create a pressure. This will create a pressure on the root. For example, when we have to drink water, we feel thirsty. Then we automatically run towards aqua guard and then we get water. Similarly, when transpiration will take place in plant body, this transpiration is just like a thirst. The plant will become thirsty and then it will ask water from the root. Done? Any doubt? Any doubt? Everything is crystal clear. Please tell me. No, no doubt. Okay. See, the story of phloem is also mentioned here as we have discussed it before only. But it's okay. Let us make the important points. When stomata are open during the day, large amount of water is lost and thus upward movement of water also becomes more. So phloem transport product of photosynthesis, that is glucose. The transport of this glucose by photosynthesis is called translocation. Energy form ATP is utilized. It means in this translocation, energy is needed in the form of ATP. The movement of substance is bidirectional. See, phloem shows bidirectional, upward as well as downwards. The same thing. Now, the last metabolic process of today's lecture is excretion. The removal of harmful nitrogenous metabolic waste from the body. Everything which we eat is not like that. Everything is useful. So there are some impurities that is present in our body, some waste material that is needed to get out of the body. And it will take place by the help of excretion. So unicellular organism will do excretion by diffusion. But it's not possible for us to do diffusion. Because we are multicellular, we have a complex structure. So we have a special organ to perform same function and that is known as excretory organ. The diagrams of all the metabolic processes are very, very, very important, kids. So in excretory system, we will see a pair of kidney. Kidney are bean shaped. After this ureter, urinary bladder, urethra. Any doubt? Now the unit of kidney. Who will tell me? Let me open the chat box. Unit of kidney. Structural and functional unit of excretion. Nephron. Very good. Nephron are the small filters that will filter the blood. Okay. So that all the impurities can go out in the form of urine. So urine is produced to filter out waste product from the blood. Nephrons are basic structural and functional unit of kidney. So there are cluster of thin walled blood capillaries called glomerulus. So see, this is the structure of a nephron. How does this nephron look like? So there will be a capsule. I will make the diagram like this, on this diagram only, so that you can understand. This is a cup shaped structure known as Bowman capsule. Inside this cup shaped structure, there is a tuft of capillaries. Tuft means bundle of capillaries. This is a bundle of capillaries known as glomerulus. So this both glomerulus plus Bowman capsule, they will become Malpighian body. Malpighian body. Okay. After this, there is this convoluted structure. Convoluted means curly, just like Maggi noodles. This is known as PCT, proximal convoluted tubule. Why it's proximal? Because it is nearer to Malpighian body. After this, the hairpin like structure, U-shaped hairpin, Judah pin, is known as loop of Henle. How is this? Loop of Henle is U-shaped. Okay. After this, once again, curly structure noodles like, it will become DCT. Distal convoluted tubule. Distal means because it is at a distance away from the Malpighian body. And after this, last is collecting duct. Collecting duct will have urine. What it will collect? Finally, urine, and then it will go into the out of the body. Any doubt? Any doubt, class? Chalo, now let us see. There are three steps in excretion. Substances like glucose, amino acids, salts. These substances are, and a major amount of water. See, water is something that we need very, very much. In our body, there is 70% of water. So why this water is very much important? Because it is a universal solvent that you have done in chemistry. Because it will allow all the molecules, most of the molecules, to get solvent in this water. So glucose, amino acid, salt. They will be soluble in the water. They will be reabsorbed. So there are three steps. Ultrafiltration, reabsorption, tubular secretion. Tubular secretion, ultrafiltration, reabsorption, tubular secretion. Why these three steps are done? See, the main agenda of the excretory system is to absorb again and again the essential nutrients. No essential nutrients should go out of the body in the form of urine. So at every step, in every step, what will happen? The important things should get reabsorbed. So that it should not go out of the body. So see, reabsorb. So if the solvent that is formed is glucose, amino acid and salts, then what will happen? They will need it to be reabsorbed because they are important. So they need it to be reabsorbed. Reabsorption depends on the amount of excess water. So that's why it is said that we should drink 12 to 13 glasses of water every day so that we don't discharge yellow color urine, because yellow color urine is concentrated urine. It means it contains little amount of waste material. So if we will drink more and more water, more and more these steps will take place and we can conserve essential nutrients. So the urine from kidney enters a long tubule called ureter, and after that what will happen? It will come into the urethra and then it will go out of the body. Any doubt? No doubt, no problem. Now we have to see excretion in plants. In plant, there is, you can't say there is an excretory organ like kidney we have. So excess things are removed in the form of transpiration. Oxygen is also a waste. When photosynthesis is done, oxygen is released, that is a waste for plant. So it is released. Some waste product may get stored in the leaves. Suppose there is a plant whose leaves are getting old. So those old leaves will have waste material that will fall off. In this way, the waste material will also get out of the plant body. Many waste products are stored in vacuoles. So if there is option that waste products are accumulated in, so it should be vacuole. Some waste products are stored as raisins, gums. So everybody know what is raisins and what is gums? That is, you can see in the hard woody part of the trunk of a tree, there is a gums, raisins. So these all are also waste material. Plant excretes some waste material into the soil around them. So there is nothing particular organ or something. Vacuole is something that will store waste material. Transpiration will be done so that release waste material. Oxygen will be released by the help of photosynthesis. Any doubt? Any doubt? Ask questions if you have any doubt or something. Doubt. Okay, Surya. What is the doubt? Hello. Surya, can you hear me? Ma'am, could you repeat the importance of reabsorption? See, reabsorption is very, very important because when this excretion process takes place, then what will happen? That there are chances that along with water, some important molecules will also get out of the body. And that is not good because glucose, amino acid, and salt, these three things are important for our body. So they should not go out of the body. But as we know that water is a universal solvent, so it will allow important molecules also to get dissolved in it. So in order to conserve these important molecules so that it should not go out of the body, this filtration process, this reabsorption means absorbing again. So the reabsorption process will take place. The essential molecule like glucose, amino acid and salt will be absorbed again from the water. So that it should not go and participate in the formation of urine. It should be conserved inside our body so that we can use it. Is it okay? Yes, we can say, Surya, it will help in maintaining the concentration of the urine. Urine is acidic or basic? Now, next question. Urine is acidic or basic? Acidic, has a good amount of uric acid. Okay, but Anirudh, if I ask that human urine contains, which nitrogenous product is present in human urine? Ammonia and urea. See, uric acid is not, we release urea as a major nitrogenous waste product because we are ureotelic. Okay, Aryan, we are ureotelic. So we release major product, that is urea. Is it okay? Is it okay? Say yes or no? Now, previous year question, have a look. List in tabular form two differentiating features between xylem and phloem. Can you do this? Comparison between xylem and phloem. Unmute your mic and tell. Siddharth, Karthik, unmute your mic and tell. Who is going to tell me? Siddharth, Karthik, can you hear me? I am audible or not? Am I audible? So why don't you give me the answer? Why don't you give me the answer?
Ma'am, could you please repeat the question?
The first question on your screen, list in tabular form two differentiating features of xylem and phloem. It's not like that you have to make table, only tell the differences. Oh, xylem transport water, phloem transport food, passive process in xylem and active process in phloem. Okay, but instead of the second point, Aryan, you can write that xylem show unidirectional movement and phloem show bidirectional movement. That will be more correct. Huh. Very good, Akshita. Now, question number two. What are the two advantages of transpiration in plants? What are the two advantages of transpiration in plants? Regulation of temperature, upward movement of water. Very good. Next, write the function of the following in the human alimentary canal. Saliva. What is the function of saliva? What is the function of saliva? Converts carbohydrates to maltosine. Shreyas, it should be convert starch. Let me write, saliva converts starch into maltose. Bile juice, what the bile juice will do? Anybody else? Emulsify, fine. Very good, Anirudh, very smart. In the same way, you have to write in the board the to the point answer. HCl in the stomach, what is the function of hydrochloric acid in the stomach? Function of hydrochloric acid. Acidic medium for action of pepsin, kill germs. Very, very nice, Aryan and Shreyas. Very good. Next, write one function of each of the following. lipase breakdown fat villi increases the surface area for example. Very good. ठीक correct. अरे next question, that is a 4-mark question. Write two different ways in which glucose is oxidized to provide energy in human body. Write the products formed in each case. You remember the chart? I have discussed this. Question number 3 answer I have already discussed in the form of chart. Very nice chart was there. You remember? So please tell the products. Who is going to tell me the products? Aerobic, anaerobic, lack of O2. What are the products? You have to draw the flow chart, but right now you need to tell me the product of anaerobic respiration. Very good. Aerobic, CO2, H2O and 38 molecule of ATP. Very nice. Mention any two components of blood. RBC and platelets. Very good. Write the function of walls present in between artery and ventricles and present between the composition of a child. Simply, we have to tell the function of walls. Unidirectional prevent backflow. Very good. Name the basic filtration unit of present in the kidney. Basic filtration unit. Nephron. Very good. Draw excretory system. This is some diagram based question. All are very, very, very important. Is a long tube which collects urine from kidney. Long tube which collects urine from kidney. Ureter. Very good. Store urine until it is passed out. Urinary bladder. Very nice. See once again two diagram based question. Respiratory system, human heart, Why is double circulation of blood necessary in human beings? Why is double circulation of blood necessary in human beings? To separate oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. Very good.
So, man, in the organisms where double circulation does not take place, do their oxygenated and deoxygenated blood like mix?
They are mixed, but they don't have heart. They don't have heart as a, you can say, circulatory organ or as a pumping organ. There is, let me tell you how to tell, see, this is a structure, venous-like structure. Suppose this is blood coming, oxygenated, then there will be a groove-like structure. Here the oxygenated blood will come and then the deoxygenated blood will move out. So it's not like that they don't have heart, but instead of heart they have some other organ that will allow the separation of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood.
So what is the function of heart in these organisms?
In these organisms there is no heart as a circulatory organ. They lack heart, or they will have three chambered heart. The heart will be two chambered, like reptiles. Crocodiles have four chambered heart. So those organisms who does not contain this heart, chambered heart structure, they have another circulatory system that will help in their exchange of blood and all. And they will also, there will be open circulatory system. You know what is open circulatory system? What is closed? Closed circulatory system is that which contains a special circulatory organ like heart. But open circulatory system, lack of circulatory organ or circulatory system. So they have open circulatory system. Surya, correct? Everybody's answer is correct. Any doubt? See, these are the questions which I have also included the answers in these questions so that you can know that how you have to write. Blood vessels, blood platelets, lymph, heart in plants synthesize of sugars occurs in leaf. The hormones are synthesized away from their target site. These all are the, see, all the questions I have mentioned in the form of points so that it will be easy for you. Is it okay? See all these answers, difference between single circulation, double circulation. Diagram based questions. This is the assignment that you have to do after class. Now once again I am asking you, is there any doubt in the class?
Ma'am, I have a small doubt.
Ask.
Ma'am, I want to know how to write this particular answer.
Okay, so which question? Let me tell you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So the question states,
Hello?
Hello, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, now. Please say the question.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, so the question states, the absorption of food in amoeba the process of absorption of food in amoeba is special. Give reason.
Okay, so you have to know how to write answer.
Yes, ma'am.
So you will write answer like this. The process of, what was the question? Ingestion of food.
Yes, ma'am.
The process of ingestion of food in amoeba is special because amoeba undergoes holozoic mode of nutrition now here para change amoeba spelling is wait amoeba exhibits a special mechanism that is mentioned below. What is the marking of the question? May I know?
This is a 2-mark question.
Okay. So simply, if it is 2-mark, holozoic mode of nutrition, question that is mentioned below. Okay, 2 marks only you have to write. Phagocytosis. Photocytosis. So phagocytosis here write down. Engulf food. Consume water. This is enough. If it will be 4-mark question, then what you will add? You will make the diagram also. The holozoic mode of nutrition diagram is given in the book. Yes or no? The food is entering. Then you will add the diagram. But in 2-mark question, it is this much only. Any else doubt?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
Anybody else? Anybody else who have doubt? No doubt. Okay, so everybody know that you have exams in the month of May. Fourth May. Okay, so what is going on in your school? What is, anybody can tell me what the school is planning? That now what you will do, I hope the course has been completed. Tons of revision, Anil. Pre-boards on Monday. Your pre-boards are starting. Very nice. So you have to go to school to write the pre-board or simply sitting home and online exam. Offline exam. Very good. Because there is no any other option. And this exam is also from May. I have seen in the newspaper that exams has been postponed. So we have enough time. Any doubt, anything that is not clear, you can ask me anytime. Any doubt?
Ma'am, once again, can you repeat the function of the BCT and DCT in nephron?
See, proximal convoluted tubule and DCT is distal convoluted tubule. Once again, let me draw the diagram so that I can explain you. You remember the diagram or I need to draw? Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So PCT, as you can see in the diagram, is near to the Bowman capsule. Is it visible? Hello?
No, ma'am, I cannot see the diagram.
Okay, just a second. Let me draw the diagram if it's not visible.
This is a human capsule. Now, so this is PCT and this one is DCT. This is Henle's loop. So the PCT will regulate pH of the filtrates by exchanging hydrogen ions. So it will help in pH maintain. Whose pH maintaining? Filtrate. The filtrate that is coming there to get filtered. So the PCT regulate pH of the filtrate by exchanging hydrogen ions in the filtrate part. DCT, it maintains a proper concentration and pH of the urine. So DCT will helps in the maintenance of pH in urine. So both they have to maintain pH. PCT will help in maintaining pH of the filtrate by exchanging H plus ions. And DCT will help in the maintaining of pH in the urine. Any doubt now?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
So everybody, best of luck for this chapter. In case any doubt, you can ask me. Next time we will meet with another lecture. Till then, bye-bye. Take care.